Father, mercy housing had no mercy. Mercy housing had no mercy. Oh, say LaCrosby. Say LaCrosby. I'm black, I'm proud, and I say it loud. I'm black, I'm proud, and I say it loud.
I want to go home, H-O-M-E. My home is at Midtown Park Apartments in the proud community of the Western District Fillmore. Where our numbers have been reduced just like Bayview, Hunters Point, to less than 3%. So let's go back to our day. So I want to go home, have my favorite beverage, get a bite to eat. We're talking basic human needs, food, water, or whatever, and shelter. My neighbor, Mr. Jose LaCrosby, was an innovator. He was a legend. When I was 4 or 5 years old, my mother was a model with him. I was fortunate enough to go see Mr. LaCrosby in the hospital. Mr. LaCrosby was frustrated. He was very upset. He was very frail. So I always like to make people laugh. So I said, hey, do you remember my mommy? I said who my mom was, and he told me this story. Can I tell you all this story? We got to honor this brother. So he did hair. And for us black folks out there, we used to fry it and lay it to the side. And it was just true, and it was known as the LaCrosby head. So he also did all the heads for the Ebony Fashion Fair. Remember that, you guys? Up at the Civic Auditorium? When the story he told me in his hospital bed, and he started getting so happy, he said, well, you know your mother was so skinny. My mother was very creaky and skinny. And so they had to have hers altered. The dress had to be made. So the models come, he's with the models, they go to pick out my mother's dress, and it wasn't sewn together. So he and the other model went into the bathroom, and sewed on the dress. And then he said they went over to the fashion show with nothing and partied all night, and it never even broke a stitch. I'm telling you, when he told that story, he started telling me about how Billie Holiday, James Brown, had stayed in his home on Fulton. And this was a great story. And then he got sad again, y'all, and I'm about to hand this over. He got sad again because he said, I have pictures. And I said, oh, I can't wait to see your pictures. He said, oh, that won't happen. And I said, why are you going to pause me? And he said, because they're packing up my stuff now. I said, that's okay. When you move to your first floor apartment, you'll have it. And he just said, whatever. So on that note, we are here to celebrate food, water, and shelter. And especially for the Western edition, especially for the working class, especially for us who work very hard and celebrate. All right? And I'm standing in front of Mercy House, and I'll let somebody else talk to you while we're in this location. But I'm going to end this with a glorious, glorious message that Mr. LaCrosby was a mentor of mine. He had style, and I think I have style. So I'm going to say in honor of Mr. LaCrosby, God bless you. Thank you for looking down on us, and your memory will not go in vain. I'd like to introduce to you now another pillar of our community, the Western Edition, Archbishop King.
Yeah. What a great man we're here for today. I'm going to share a little secret with some of y'all. There's an article that said, well, he was a beautician at one time. I went to cosmetology school. I took care of my family. Dying and crying, and going to the side. So, as a beauty culture student, of course, you look up to Mr. LaCrosby. There's some place that you might want to be if you wanted to make a real living and to be somebody in that field. So I have that same kind of affection for that brother. And if you wanted to be cleaner than the state where he said, you know, show off his back with his out in the back, then you look at Mr. LaCrosby with that baby on. Every time I seen him, he was sharp as a tack. But beyond that, the one my temple used to serve three vegetarian meals, and then we used to have these celebrations on Thanksgiving to save Mom and Tom turkey and have vegetarian Thanksgiving. You know, the people wasn't really with that. When Thanksgiving time, they want to kill a turkey. So, Mr. LaCrosby, when we started serving turkeys, Mr. LaCrosby would make sure that there was a dozen turkeys there for the people. If he didn't do that, he'd send $300, $400, $500, $600 to the program. So when we talk about Mr. LaCrosby, we're not just talking about a hairdresser, an entrepreneur, but we're talking about a man that had a heart for the people. He loved the people of San Francisco, and he put his money where his mouth was, where his heart was. So I am glad to be a part of this celebration of a life that set a page for all of us as an example of what we can do besides just talk. And it's important that the God planted him in mercy houses so that we can use this opportunity to raise some consciousness about the absence of mercy in so-called mercy houses, and that there is a need for us to continue to heighten the contradiction around the crime that's being committed about the folks that were lied to, robbed, and this community. And see, you have to understand that Midtown was a prideful place for us as a people. Because you were in a community that stayed in that complex. And it gave us all hope of someday that we too might be able to own something. But little did we know that working behind the sound folks and the police walked away free, they also killed black and brown communities with impunity. Nobody stands up of those that could make a difference. And so this is a matter of taking place. You're killing the black community. You're killing the brown community. This ain't just about an issue about who's going to manage the building. There's a robbery going on that started in Fillmore, went all across this nation. If you go to Chicago, you're not going to see the Robert Taylor Project, so they'll tear them all down. You go to Harlem, you're going to get lost because you ain't going to see the people that you know should be there. And this is what's happening to San Francisco. And we can't lighten up. We got to just turn up the heat, hide your contradiction, and keep telling the story that mercy, what is it called? Mercy housing? But they got to, and again, I'll say this again, where is the archbishop? Is this tied to the Roman Catholic Church? Is this tied to the sisters of, well, it's time for them to stand up and say something about that. So I'm just glad to be here, and I'm glad to see folks are not giving up the fight. So we're going to fight, finish, and win. You do it? All right. I love you. God bless you.
Yeah!
Daniel, please, sometimes it's a real community new leadership foundation.
So,
are you done
with
your
science?
Yeah,
I stay in the field where I was born and raised, and I went to school, which used to be Franklin Little School, which is across the street from this town. So, you know, just real simple, we stand in solidarity with Midtown and everyone who's been receiving this city backlash of removing people from their homes. This is something that, of course, as you all know, has happened nationwide, and this is something that the city has been having a playbook for years. Now, I say King Garvey. King Garvey is going to do something similar and went through something similar that Midtown Housing. Although we're a co-op on paper, the people don't believe they own the property. So the people don't consider themselves shareholders and owners. They carry themselves like tenants, which is a big difference. So if we're not going to get no mercy for mercy, they got to go. The Bible says that foxes have holes, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Why not? It's because we are looking at a society and a world now that have devalued human lives.
Right.
Yeah. To have basic needs, a roof over your head, is taken off the table when it comes to money, when it comes to developers, greedy developers, whether it's Lenore, whether it's Mercy, whether it's John Stewart, this is something that's a collective effort of evil.
That's right.
So let's stand in solidarity.
Right.
Like we're fighting for justice for Mario Woods, but also we're fighting for housing. Because if you have housing, if you have a foundation, you don't end up being put in the streets in a position where the police can say, you know, this is one that we can take down like an animal. So we stand with you, and we support you, and let us know every step of the way, because we got to have each other back on this one. All of us, young, old, poor. And even some of you got a little money, let's come together and let's fight. Finish.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm trying to get back to my life. And I had to leave a seminar out in South San Francisco, Les Brown, get motivated. And I got to tell you, one of those speakers said, and I just felt it in my bones, and I want to say this to you guys. It's about saying, but it's about doing. It's about taking action. It's about putting those shoes on and providing for you to come out and be heard. Because there goes I. There goes Jose LaCrosby. There goes I.
All right.
I'd like to introduce, now that I've brought it down a little bit, I'd like to introduce to you Mr. LaCrosby's son, Peter John.
My father has been moving housing for quite a long time. He's old school, and he's hardcore when it comes to going out and being who he is. And the one thing he was more than anything else was a master of race violence. He was the first man to come through the Raymond School of Cosmetology. And when he was a student there, they made him go to the back. He paved the way, and he, along with a lot of other pioneers of that time and era, you know, participated in the heyday of hairstyles. But, you know, it was all done in the chair, and here in San Francisco, people would tell me all the time, your father gave my mother's hair, my grandmother's hair. Right, a lot of guys too. All of the operators in the 38 are in Newton. We took the bus every day downtown. All the operators in AC Transit went in when we go to these shops. We've had shops all over the city. I'm drawing a blank. The last year that he was at the VA hospital, all he was waiting for was his apartment to be transferred down to the first floor. I didn't know it at the time, but I think there was some kind of stall up. It should have happened. I know that on the gentrification west side, there are changes that are going on in the building. A lot of people came and went. I can say that some girls up to the first floor was not a priority. My father participated in the meetings, and I just thank everybody for coming out. There's a million and one things I could say that is not prepared from my heart, but I can tell you that my father was steady, and he was passionate. He was passionate about his job, he was passionate about his craft, and I could go on and on. But he also was passionate about living at mercy housing. Midtown housing. So I just want everybody to keep on fighting. Don't let up. Don't let up. I used to be a cement truck driver here in San Francisco, and I can tell you that not only with the gentrification, but the building is going like crazy. You can't make new land, but you can clear off land and build something bigger and better in your space. I've been seeing that grow up for some time. I grew up in the city. Once upon a time, you could get an apartment, a flat, for $500. Those days are gone. And look around. It's all about the dollar bill, y'all. Okay? And we're going to get pushed out. So please, continue to fight. And I want to thank each and every one of you for coming out here and raising a joyful noise for my father. Thank you.
All right. We're with you.
Thank you. We have Tony. The other thing that I love as I look around is, you know, San Francisco is a rainbow. We're everybody. We are black, we are brown, we are yellow. Oh, my God, we're everything early in between. So thank you all for coming to support us. It's not just Black Homes Matter and Black Lives Matter. It's definitely the city matters, working class matters. And I'd like to bring up to you Tony, one of our great supporters. And this brother, when I talk about action, because that's what we're about right now. I'm sick of complaining and crying in my martini. But here we go, Tony. You ready? Let him have it.
Go, Tony.
No, we keep doing this song and dance about we ain't got no money. You know, what Poor Magazine calls the scarcity model. You know, we don't have money. It's not in our budget. But they can find money to put up these luxury condos and rich people housing. They have enough money to drop millions of dollars on that motherfucking farce of a Super Bowl. Super Bowl City that just happened down at Embarcadero. They have money for that shit, but they don't have money to house their own people. They can drop $5 million on that Budweiser Miller Lite shit, but not enough money to put into existing housing. And that's the honest to God's truth. When I heard that Mr. LaCrosby had passed, I felt very bad because that was somebody, I didn't know Mr. LaCrosby, but that was somebody who was the vanguard of our community, somebody who was a connection to our past. And it seems like with each passing day, the people in the city, that means the people that are running the shit, are trying to cut ties with all of the connections to our past, which made the connections that made our city the place that it is. And I heard the brother say that, you know, they're going through things over at your housing complex. You know, I think the thing is it's a matter of equity, you know, a matter of community, a matter of equity, a matter of ownership. and how, you know, you can have an apartment complex that had a mortgage that had already been paid, and you had residents there that already had equity, to have that equity just taken away from them, and to have Mr. LaCrosby in his last days be treated with such disrespect. Mercy Housing is opening a housing community or a building not far from here, and they're calling it the Bill Soro Family Housing Project. If you don't know who Bill Soro is, Bill Soro was the founder of Manila Town Heritage Foundation. He was one of the main organizers in the fight for the I Hotel.
Wow.
For the I Hotel, the International Hotel, that, you know, once that was demolished, it spelled the end of the Filipino community on Kearney Street. And I just find it extremely hypocritical that you can be treating the brothers and sisters of this community that way, while at the same time say, oh, we're going to name a community housing building after the late Bill Soro. And that doesn't sit well with me whatsoever. So, again, you know, on behalf of Manila Town Heritage Foundation, on behalf of the memory of those elders that were forcibly evicted in 1977, we say love to the spirit of Mr. LaCrosby, who I know would want us to continue fighting this, to continue fighting, continue all the way to the end, which, you know, we know that the end is always the beginning.
You know what? Every time someone speaks, it reminds me of something. I'm only talking for me. Everything I say is about me. I am scared living in my home I've been in for 21 years. I have a little thing that I put up to my door, and on Fridays my brother comes by and drops up food for me, and I fell asleep and forgot it, and he had to break in to get in. That's because I'm so scared. They have reduced our security. Do you know when I wrote them and I said I'm scared to just walking around that don't have any IDs, and I don't know who they are. If they are construction contractors, please have them have a badge or something. I'm scared. Do you know I have yet? That was 2 months to reach today.
Okay.
And they said that they're putting cameras in because this is the best thing for us.
Really?
They said that to us. We feel this is the best thing. What happens to us women who are working the night shift, let me hear you, at 4 o'clock in the morning, we used to pick up the phone and say, hey, Fred, you know, I'm coming down to the garage. Can you come get me, Fred? They're waiting for you, chatting you up. Then, and there when you get home. What about that? You're helping us, Mercy Housing?
No.
And you do say with pride. You guys don't know that we're helping you. I don't know how to understand how that's happening when I'm scared now. Strangers with keys walking around. And now LaCrosby, what can I say? Okay, I got a young brother who's up next to talk. Daniel, please.
Come on, get
up.
Good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to meet here, and I'm honored to share my heart with y'all. I didn't personally know Mr. LaCrosby, but from the stories that I've heard just in this brief moment, it sounds like he stood for self-determination, entrepreneurship, the ability to create for yourself, and independence, right? And for a group of people who desire to own their own homes, these are all things that you have the right to.
Yeah.
These are all characteristics and attributes that you have the right to access and exercise. But when somebody wants to take your home from you,
come on now.
They don't only take these attributes, but they begin messing with your freedom.
Right. Right.
They begin messing with your liberty. And they begin messing with your access to a fruitful life that you can desire and determine for yourself.
Come on now. Take it.
They call themselves mercy.
Take it, brother.
The Pope himself declared that 2016 was a year of mercy. Imagine that, right?
Imagine that.
Go figure. Mercy is the ability to forgive, to show love, to accept, thank you, compassion. But when someone takes your creative abilities away, when someone takes away your self-determination, your dignity, thank you, Archbishop, when someone takes away the number one characteristic of a fruitful life, Housing, where are you left to go after that? And this is happening all around the city, right? We know the stories. My grandparents moved from the south to Louisiana, from Louisiana to Harbor Road. They moved over to the Excelsior. Excelsior's next on the list. Fortunately, we found a place in Freedom West down the street. But we see it. Three developments within two blocks of my home. And the city, I don't know if you know Freedom West, four square blocks of cooperatively owned housing. The city had the nerve to offer us less than $1 million to take up that property. The city don't want you to live on your own. The city don't want you to determine for yourself your future. Just as Phyllis said today, we have to act. This is our right for self-determination. This is our call to self-determination. You have a choice. Every morning you wake up to let the people you love know that you're in it for them and to let the city know that you're not going to tolerate it anymore. Determine for yourself today what you will have.
Thank you. You know what? Everything just reminds me. Let me tell you something else, Mercy Housing of California at Midtown Park. Let's be very specific. I'm not making a general statement. This is specifically what has happened at Midtown Park apartment. One of my neighbors was upstairs asleep in his bedroom. Mercy Housing came, knocked on the door. There was no answer. They used the key to get in. There was a chain lock on. I don't know about you guys, but if I ever try to open a door that I have the key to, and there's a chain, that means what? Somebody's home. So Mercy said, according to their policy, they cut the chain lock. Went upstairs, opened the door in his bedroom, and he stood up and said, I can't say what he said. We got accused of being violent. We got accused of you can't even come into the manager's office without an escort or we'll call the police.
Come on now.
I'm just giving you another one of our smart grievances of why we want them gone.
That's right.
Gone. Mercy House out of Midtown.
Out.
We have a tenant here. Just got brought it down a little bit, y'all. Come on, Pat. Pat is a long-term tenant at Midtown.
Come on, Pat.
Go, Pat. Go, Pat.
About following all these powerful speakers. I've been in Midtown for 45 years. 45 years. I've raised three or four families there because I'm a foster parent, I'm an adoptive parent, and I'm a parent and a grandparent. So I don't know. I've really not that many children because I keep them. I don't like some foster parents, so they'll be there a minute and gone. But no, they've all been raised in my home and they stay there. 27 years old is the oldest one I have in the house right now. So I just want to say I've been there for 45 years. I've seen a lot of changes going on, and this is the worst management we've ever had. The thing God is watching you too, Mercy.
That's right.
And beyond Mercy, there are other tenants that are being put out. The nuns in the Tenderloin are being put out of a building that they are feeding hundreds of people every day. And this is so wrong. This is so wrong. And Mercy, maybe you can offer them a place. You can offer them a place because you're so close to God, I'm sure. You know, so, yeah, Mercy can show some mercy to those people. I watched my neighbor, Mr. LaCrosby, many other neighbors. I go visit a neighbor now up in Fairfield who had a stroke coming down the hallway, and she had to crawl to another neighbor's door because she was so upset about what was going on in the building. From day to day, she didn't know whether she had a home or not. And she finally had a stroke, and she's up in Fairfield because they couldn't find any place closer. And I have to go up there and visit her, you know, not as often as I'd like to, but, I mean, this is ridiculous. This is not a way that people should live. People should not have to ask permission to have company over. And they've asked that of us. They've asked us to give a 30-day notice if we want somebody to spend the night. They've asked us to do things that we don't. Who are we? Are we criminals? I don't know. I don't understand this. Are we in the military? What's going on?
You know, I understand this. I've never known of a life like this. This has not been my life, and it's not been my life. But, yeah, they don't trust that I have enough judgment to know who should and shouldn't come on the property. And if children under 18, they had it written that if children under 18 come on, they have to be accompanied by a resident. And they can't be on the ground. So my children can't have their friends over.
I should call them.
This is their policy. So it's not just putting us out, but as we live there, we are basically being driven out. Even if they lower the rent, even if they leave the rent alone and leave us alone in terms of that, it's harassment, straight up harassment. We don't have a chance to live a normal life. Like, I don't know any of them that they would have to ask permission for everything. You can't even enter your door if you don't have certain attire on. To me, it's just crazy. The world has gone crazy. That's all I have to say.
Come on, Pat.
Jay LaCrosby lives in a world. Jay LaCrosby lives in a.
That reminds me of one of the little grievances. It's not little, but one of my neighbors. Let them know that they let Mercy know that she didn't want them coming in unless she was home because she had children at home alone. They came in, knocked on the door, kept knocking on the door. The young woman inside alone answered the door. What do you want? We're in here to do an inspection. And she let them in, and three strange men went through the apartment without the permission of the parents. Just thought I'd drop that out for you. We have another speaker. One thing that we have going on is that we have solidarity.
That's right, solidarity over here.
No matter how they told you not to support us, and I know they did, they stood by it. They stood by us. So I'd like to bring out Claudia from United Education San Francisco Union.
Thank you.
No, I just have something really short to say, and I'm really proud to be here. I'm representing the Teachers Union here, Educators Union San Francisco. We did pass a resolution in solidarity with the Midtown residents through our union, so that was great. Yes.
Yeah.
And we did also push through a resolution at the Labor Council in solidarity with the Midtown residents, which was really great. All I have to say is that, you know, the same forces that are pushing out the Midtown residents are also pushing out the teachers.
That's right.
We have all kinds of solidarity with all of you.
Yes.
You know, not only are your children and your grandchildren our students, and we hear their stories and we live with that in the classroom, but when we go home, we are facing the exact same thing. You know, the same mayor who is prioritizing this enormous corporation, the NFL, and spending $5 million, right? And then at the same time telling the homeless people that they have to get lost, right? You know, he's increasing homelessness, right? The same mayor that's prioritizing that is also prioritizing the building of luxury housing in the heart of working class on San Francisco.
Yes.
I live in the Mission, and we have units going up that are two bedrooms for $12,000 a month. We have condominiums that are being sold for $1.8 million on the cheap side. So teachers are saying, where are we supposed to live? So what are we going to do? And so we stand in solidarity with all of you, because enough is enough.
Enough is enough. No more.
What do you do when the greed attacks? We say, what do we do when the greed attacks? We say, hell no.
Fight back.
What do we do when the greed attacks? We say, hell no.
Fight back.
Thank you, thank you. And,
Sister Claudia.
Oh, sorry, Claudia. I thought you were Claudia. I'm so sorry.
Hi, my name is Claudia Torello. I am also for United Educators. I'm also here as a tenant fighting our evictions for years. And my son, too, is here because he's fighting evictions, too.
Right on. Yes.
Yay! Another big kid.
Yay! You know, he's being evicted, too, from his home. And so we're here in solidarity with you guys because we... know how hard it is to stand up and fight and organize against these incredibly strong forces against you. But when we shed the light on these forces, things change, because we need to shed the light. We need to explain our narrative, our stories, and why it's important to keep fighting here, and what happened, you know, why are we out here on the street, and why won't we be out here on the street and we lose our homes? We need to explain to people that homelessness is not a crime, you know. It's almost like you're just a bad person if you can't afford a $1 million condo here in San Francisco. So I think that we just need to stick together and expose what's happening, and also just organize and come together with everybody so that you guys can own this building legally and not be swept away. Yes, we've already paid for it, so you should own it. And it shouldn't be the city that decides who owns it when you've already paid it and it's made it like a criminal crime to have paid off all your mortgage. And so I think it's really important that we stay together and keep ourselves in our homes that we've known for many years, and respect our elders and not watch them die in fighting their eviction. It's such a painful thing to have your house, you know, attacked and your home attacked. And so I'm here in solidarity for you guys, because we're there with you in this battle. And my son was born, and he's been battling his evictions ever since. So we're here for you, and you can count on us.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. You know what? One of the things that happens in the paper and in conversations about Midtown is they say it's so complicated. I'm going to uncomplicate it. The first thing is, we have a property manager that abuses us. We want them gone. All right?
Good.
That's number one. All right. Tiny? Tiny?
Thank you. Tiny.
All right.
Okay. Midtown apartment. Needs to belong to the people!
Yeah. Yeah.
Midtown apartments is self-determination!
Yeah.
And this is our lonely land. This isn't the man's land or mercy housing. Can I also put a word in your mouth, everybody? It's called non-profit cheers! They're making serious money on our property, or our presumed poverty, and making sure we stay that way so they can keep making that money. Be very clear about that. So that's what we're here to do. We're just going to spend a real quick time, and then we'll say a word. So I'm turning to my brother, D. Allen, introduce himself.
Hello, Dylan.
D. Allen. D. Allen from Deep East Oakland, by way of San Francisco, by way of Atlanta, from the East Coast to the West Coast, African Italian, anti-racist, anti-state poverty scum.
Queen 98. Every time we conquer another battle, we just put on our hoodies and say what's next. Born and raised in San Francisco. Three-time generation. Ashe, KLS, Lily Mae, Brenton Lee, a poor magazine, super baby mama, and a welfare queen.
All right.
I am the poverty scholar, criminalized, racialized, and artisan struggling for $1. I'm all the people you don't want to see, never want to be. Look away from me. What you gonna do, arrest me? I'm in your city. I am a poverty scholar, and I rock this jailhouse attire, because me and my poor mama did jail time, just trying to stay alive in this horror. I am the poverty scholar, the melanin challenged daughter of a strong woman of color, for without whom there would be no me, a mama so fed it, and a welfare queen. We're going to say a quick bit. I just want to say we are the Poets Project, that poets in poverty using the word to heal, educate, and relate how to survive and thrive through race and class oppression. But I want to be very clear that up in Bayview, Hunters Point right now, there's over 500 forcibly abandoned buildings, because Lenore is about to make millions and billions of dollars re-devil-oping them. Listen to the words. Because Lenore needs to save us. Yeah, no, we don't need your saving, Lenore Corporation. Just like we don't need your fake-ass mercy housing. What we need is self-determination. We got beautiful tenants here.
mismanagement. Give the reparations back to the generation.
Yeah.
I'll say.
Come on.
Sitting on the dock of the bay, watching our home get taken away. Sitting on the dock of the bay, you gon' pay for your crime.
That's right, you gon' pay for your crime. All the gentrification that's going on in San Francisco, that's why it's called San Francisco. Because you out your mind. This is a form of elder abuse right here. And you need to be in somebody's hall of injustice being charged with a 368B crime, which is elder abuse. Why don't you throw a shag to do it on the trip right there? Right, where's Scooby at? Okay, you go over there and find Scooby. Let me finish this. Now, what I was saying is you are throwing our elders out in the street, and you are disrespecting our elders without them, it was not being no us. That is California Penal Code 368. That is a form of elder abuse. And just like any civilian, you double lopers need to be charged for that too. I don't see mercy housing. I see hellish housing. Because we catching hell because all we want is a roof over our head. Whether I sit up there and make toilet paper out of $100 bills and put people down and call them homeless like that's a goddamn tribe walking the earth. They are people too. And the reason why San Francisco ain't got no money because y'all too busy spending y'all money on y'all mistresses in Las Vegas. That's what y'all was doing and letting the family sit out here and down the street. That is a crime. You should not criminalize the people because they're going through poverty, because you are the reason why the people are going to poverty. You need to be charged with a crime of impoverishment. Period, point blank.
Hey, that's
this is a form of elder abuse, just like along with a lot of our elders who were evicted and put out on the street and they died out in the street. That's not no place for our elders to be. And while you sit up here and what else you're doing, that's a goddamn blasphemy to call yourself mercy housing. You don't know nothing about no God and no mother nature. All you know how to do is kill and do and destroy. So to me, that's satanic. And all this shit right now is you better repent your greedy ass ways, because as you make people fall down to their knees and you kill them, you're going to have to answer to our God and our goddess, baby. And trust me, I don't want to be there when you lose your head to the sword. So give San Francisco back to the people and let's house the family and get your merciless asses up out of here is what you need to do.
Thank you so much. Now, I want to be really clear once again. Mercy Housing, California. We want them out of Midtown Park apartments because they break into our homes when our daughters are alone. The seniors can't reach down to the first floor. Our cars get torn. Okay? Just really clear. Let's stay focused. We want Mercy Housing out because of things they've done. All right? So we're bringing up right now for a really quick wrap up here. Thank you so much. Introduce yourself.
Hey everyone, I'm Shannon Golden from the People's Campaign, and you might know our little 10,000 person strong Facebook group called Vote 123 to Replace Ed Lee. And I'm here today in solidarity with the folks of Midtown against merciless housing. And I wanna share a little chant that we have from the campaign, and I wanna repurpose it for us. And I want you to join with me, and it goes Vote 1-2-2-3. Replace mercy. Vote. 1-2-2-3. Replace mercy. Vote. 1-2-2-3. Replace mercy. Vote. 1-2-2-3. Replace mercy.
Okay. What does it take for the mayor to do the right thing? Why does a nonprofit that everybody thinks is a nonprofit, but yet it is a fox in the henhouse? Don't get it twisted. This is a greedy developer. This is a greedy developer. All right, this is a greedy developer who all they care about is getting our money and displacing folks that are poor, displacing the disenfranchised. So, once again, Save Midtown is here for you. We urge you to support the Justice for Marvin Woods Coalition. We urge you to support the African Orthodox Church in the Fillmore. And now all we have is our good friend Francisco Herrera and Brother Francis that have recently learned that Francisco Herrera is gonna run for the District 11 supervisor. You gonna die? appreciate you both for here.
Okay, and after they finish, we're going to actually wrap up. So I want to know, everybody, Facebook, Save Midtown.
Yes, please.
Hashtag Save Midtown.
Yes,
also, SaveMidtown.org. There's a petition. Please go sign our petition. We also have a petition here rotating around. Please just support us. We need your prayers and we need your support. And we're all in this together. So, girl, we're going to leave with some great harmony and hopefully somebody good in our local government. Francisco!
Go ahead.
No, no. No, just like a tree that's planted by the water. We shall not be moved. For when eviction protection, we shall not be moved. For when eviction protection, we shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. Young as mother, we're more inclined to end strife. Young as mother, we're more inclined to end strife. Young as mother, just like a tree that's planted by the water. No, no, housing is for people, we shall not be moved. Housing is for people, we shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. We shall not be moved. Not for landlord profit, we shall not be moved. Not for landlord profit, we shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. We shall not be moved. We shall not be moved. We shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. We shall not be moved.
Okay, folks, thank you very much. Everybody grab a sign.
We're going to do a group dance here. Coming in, my dad would have really been happy. He would have laughed and laughed if he'd never heard before to see you guys here now, and he probably is. I just want to thank each and every one of you so very much. This is a huge fight. Bring it to light. Tell your friends. Tell your neighbors. Spread it.
Spread it. Spread it. Spread it. Spread the word. Bring
tell
more soldiers. Spread the word.
Box.
Tell more people. Spread the word. We're getting Christ out of San Francisco.
Right.
Oakland's too expensive. Fairfield will soon be too expensive.
Yeah.
How is the city going to function? without us, they'll find a way. Okay? They will find a way. But we cannot, will not, shall not be priced out.
Yes, that's right.
Thank you so very much. Tell a friend. Tell a friend. Each one of you, tell 10. Tell them to tell 10.
Okay.
Let's raise an army. Let's raise a tide that we're not going to take it. We're not going to get priced out.
That's right.
Thank you very much, brother. The son of Jose LaCrosby right here with us. Folks, we will not be priced out. We are organizing. Just like your brother said, tell a friend, we are organizing. We are organizing. We are winning. We have to tell our people. We will change this thing. Turn it around and save Midtown.
Turn it around and save Midtown.
Turn it around and save Midtown. Turn it around and save Midtown. Turn it around and save Midtown. Because this thing is about love. This thing is about love. It's about real mercy. So as we leave, please find a person. Give them an embrace. A warm hug, because this is a long-term walk. This is a long-term campaign. We are creating a vision for working people to live and flourish right here. Live and flourish right here. Live and flourish. Our kids. Who else? Get our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren. We are about staying and flourishing. Give each other a warm embrace. We are winning and we will win. Gracias.
Thank you very much. We're done. Thank you, guys.